So good evening, everybody. So we are going to discuss about a very important topic today. It's about IV fluid in pediatrics. Whenever you see this topic, sometimes you may have a question. So what is to discuss about this? Because now every day, all the admissions, most of the admissions are on IV fluids. So this is day-to-day practice. This is what we are doing in all the pediatric wards. So what to discuss? I also had the same question. So these are the basic fluids that we're using. We are familiar with oral rehydration fluids, normal saline, and then this is 3% saline, and this is normal saline with 5% dextrose. So we have the curiosity, what to discuss? As you all know, this is the beginning. So in 1956, Holliday and Sega published this landmark paper about the parenteral fluid therapy in pediatrics. So since then, there were a lot of discussions, a lot of arguments, whether it should be normal saline, whether it should be hypotonic saline, whether it should be normal saline with 5% dextrose, whether it should be N by 2, N by 5, and a lot of discussions. So I thought it's better to discuss about physiology, then what we should use as a maintenance IV fluids, and then in specific diseases, what should be our fluid, specifically very important topics like hypernatremia, diabetic ketoacidosis, RAS ICP, dengue, and septic shock. To discuss about IV fluids, I think it's very important to know these concepts. What do you mean by osmolality? Osmolality is a concentration of a solution, but the units are different. It's a concentration of solution expressed as the number of solute molecules per kilogram of solution. Whenever you have concentration, you should be writing in milligrams per deciliter. In other words, micrograms per liter. So we are discussing about the volume, but here is solute molecules per kilogram of solution. So normal plasma osmolality is 280 to 295 milliosmoles per 1 kilo or liter. And this is very tightly controlled by antidiuretic hormone. It's called ADH. And what about the tonicity? We are very frequently using these two terms interchangeably, but this is a completely different scenario, completely different concept. So tonicity is a measure of osmotic pressure gradient between two solutions separated by a semi-permeable membrane. There should be a semi-permeable membrane, one side one solution, the other side other solution. So tonicity is the concentration gradient, osmotic pressure gradient. So one is having a higher osmotic pressure, the other one is having a lower osmotic pressure. So which one is having a higher osmotic pressure has hypertonic solution when compared to the other solution. That's all about tonicity. And you can understand it is only influenced by solutes that cannot cross the membrane. If the solutes can cross the membrane, there's no relative tone, relative tonicity, because easily it can be, the solute can be cross the membrane, so that the tonicity is same. And in reality, it is mainly depend on sodium. So when you're discussing about tonicity, there are three main topics. There are hypotonic solution, there are isotonic solution, there are hypertonic solution. So we are comparing this with plasma. So this is my membrane. This is the cell. This is outside the cell. So if the outside solution is having less solute molecules, So this one is a hypotonic solution when compared to the inside the cell. If the same amount of solutes are there, it should become isotonic solution because it's equal to the cell. In hypertonic solution, it has more solutes. The tonicity is more can compare to the intracellular compartment. So it's a hypertonic solution. So this is all about tonicity. If the solute is freely movable, no tonicity at all. Now think, if this solute is freely movable, this side is having a higher concentration, definitely the solutes will shift from inside the cell to outside the cell. With time, it will become an equal amount of solutes on both sides. So solutes which are freely movable cannot create a tonicity. Tonicity is a concentration gradient. We are discussing about in relation to another fluid. And this concept is very, very important to understand. The iso or smaller solutions, which are not isotonic. Iso or smaller means equal to plasma. You can think about 5% dextrose, osmolality is 286. So it's equal to, the osmolality is equal to plasma. However, this dextrose can freely move to inside, outside, wherever it's having high concentration to lower concentration. So dextrose can freely move across the membrane. So the dextrose cannot contribute to tonicity. So it's a hypotonic solution. So 5% dextrose having a iso or smaller, but it's a hypotonic solution. So this concept is very important. So if you compare the fluids that we are commonly used, you can see normal saline, sodium content is 154, osmolality is usually 2 times sodium, it is 308. So it's iso or smaller, osmolality is compared to plasma, it's same or similar. So it's isotonic because it's sodium. Half normal saline is 77, 154, it's hypo or smaller and hypotonic. But look at this, 5% dextrose, it doesn't have any sodium ions, but the osmolality is 286, so it's iso or smaller. Osmolality is equal to plasma, but however, there's no tonicity because dextrose can freely move, so it's hypotonic. Half normal saline with 5% dextrose, look at this, its osmolality is 432, so it's hyper or smaller when compared to the plasma. However, it's hypotonic. 1/5 normal saline with 4% dextrose, 284, iso or smaller, but hypotonic. Normal saline with 5% dextrose, osmolality is 586. So it's a hyper or smaller solution, but dextrose cannot create tonicity, so it's isotonic. Ringer's lactate, 278, iso or smaller, and isotonic. So this understanding about the tonicity and the osmolality is very important to discuss what type of fluid that we should use in specific conditions when you're going to discuss. Right, now we can see if you put a cell into these three solutions. First, we think about the cell, you make it set cells, is in isotonic solution. So tonicity is equal on both sides. So nothing will happen. No net shift of fluid from outside to inside or inside to outside. The cell is very happy. But what will happen if the same cell in hypotonic solution? So tonicity is high in the intracellular compartment. So water should go into the cell. So this cell should swollen up. If the same cell is in hypertonic solution, that means tonicity is higher in the solution, outside solution, than the cell. So water should shift from intracellular to extracellular compartment. So this same cell will shrunken up because it's in hypertonic solution. So this is exactly what will happen whenever you are using this type of solution. Then, what should be our maintenance fluid? As I mentioned earlier, there were a lot of discussions, a lot of arguments. When we were registrars, we were using N by 5 as the normal maintenance fluid in pediatrics. This is about 10, 12 years back. But after a lot of discussions, now you have realized if you are using hypotonic solutions, that's not physiological. The cell, this poor cell will swollen up. So there's a lot of discussions. And in 2018, they have published this article. This is about the clinical practice guidelines in maintenance intravenous fluid in children, published in, by the American Academy of Pediatrics in 2018. So this says, it recommends that the patients 28 to 18 years of age requiring maintenance IV fluid should receive isotonic solutions with appropriate KCL and dextrose because they significantly decrease the risk of developing hyponatremia. Evidence quality is A, that means recommendation is strength is strong. So in other words, all the patients that we are looking after as pediatricians, this is beyond the neonatal period up to 18 years, maintenance fluid should be isotonic, no place for hypotonic solutions at all. And it should contain dextrose, and depending on your potassium level, it should contain some KCL also. The evidence is very strong. So now it's very simple. We should use normal saline all the cases that we are looking after for the maintenance fluid. Then we'll go to specific disorders. How can you look after various disorders with IV fluids? So this is about hyponatremia. The definition of hyponatremia is the sodium less than 135 millimoles per liter. But the symptoms starts to occur when the sodium is less than 125 millimoles per liter or serum sodium has fallen very, very rapidly. So now we have discussed about the physiology. So it's very simple. Now you can understand what will happen if you use hypotonic fluids in these children. The acute hyponatremia can cause death from cerebral edema and brain herniation. So you can see this is the normal brain and this is the hyponatremic brain. So the sodium is low, that means osmolality is low, that means tonicity is low, that means hypotonic solution. So fluid should go into the cell. If we are discussing about the brain cell will swollen up. So that is cerebral edema. And you are creating a high pressure inside this closed container. Now the stress ICP can cause brain herniation. So it's very simple to understand if you know the physiology. So this very sad situation. So this 22-year-old man died after completing his first marathon because he drank too much water. This happens in 2007. The sodium was 122. So this patient has died because of hyponatremia, which caused the cerebral edema and corneal. Right. So how can you prevent this? No hyponatremic IV fluids. Always use normal saline. So it's very simple. All the conditions, we should use normal saline. Whenever possible, ask them to check to enteral feed because our body is very, body's fluid handling is very, very efficient. So whatever the things that we are taking, depending on the needs, the body will handle it. So if you can allow body to handle it, then it's very easy. So whenever the possible, enteral feeding is a must. And if you want to give as a maintenance fluid, it should be, as we discussed earlier, it should be normal saline with 5% dextrose, in other words, DNS. So especially the conditions which cause high antidiuretic hormone conditions. So if you are using more than 50% IV fluids, so we have to do serum electrolytes at least twice a day so to prevent the various complications that we can cause. So what are the symptoms for hyponatremia? I'm not going to go into details. You know all these things: headache, nausea, vomiting, lethargy or irritability, hyperreflexia, decreased consciousness states, and at the end, seizures. So how can you manage? So these are the principles of management. What they say is, if the patient is symptomatic, if it is a symptomatic hyponatremia, if they have symptoms due to hyponatremia, you have to treat urgently and rapidly. If the child is asymptomatic, just we have done the electrolytes and you can see the sodium level is low, but the child is walking around. So basically treat slowly. And very, very frequent serum electrolyte monitoring we should do. Then we can see what to do. Symptomatic hyponatremia. So it may be convulsions, maybe drowsiness, it may be some other symptom. So if they are having symptomatic hyponatremia, like all the critically ill patients, so airway, breathing, circulation is your first priority. And then your aim is to increase your sodium up to 125 millimoles. So if you increase the sodium to 125 millimoles per liter, then your symptoms will disappear. So basically, you are making symptomatic hyponatremia into asymptomatic hyponatremia. How can you do that? You can give 3% saline, 4 to 5 ml per kilo, over 15 to 30 minutes as a bolus. By giving this, you can increase your sodium by 3 millimoles per liter. That usually stops the seizures. If you have ongoing seizures, you can repeat the same dose again as a bolus. And once the seizure has controlled, once the symptomatic hyponatremia has become asymptomatic hyponatremia, then you have to shift to slow sodium correction. The expected sodium correction is about 8 millimoles per liter per day. So for 24 hours, you are correcting up to 8 millimoles per liter. So if you have asymptomatic hyponatremia, your sodium level is low, but no symptoms. So how to manage will depend on the volume status. If there's no dehydration, moderate dehydration, or severe dehydration. So whatever it is, active correction of 3% saline is not necessary if it is an asymptomatic hyponatremia. And the expected sodium correction is 8 millimoles per liter per day. So if you have asymptomatic hyponatremia without dehydration, that means normal or increased volume status, what you have to do is restrict water to slowly remove the increased body water. Don't use hypotonic solution. This is very important. Please don't use hypotonic solution anyway. If you have asymptomatic hyponatremia with moderate dehydration, you can make nasogastric rehydration with ORS. If not, if the child is not tolerating ORS, you can give IV rehydration with normal saline. And this is for your information. And as you all know, the ORS, this is very important, has only 75 to 90 millimoles per liter of sodium. So it's very hyponatremic solution. Even though you think ORS contains a lot of sodium, it is about half normal saline. So that you have to remember. So you cannot correct sometimes the hyponatremia by this ORS. So if you're having asymptomatic hyponatremia with severe dehydration, you have to rehydrate with normal saline. So give normal saline with 5% dextrose until the child can take enteropathy. That's the normal, that's the maintenance fluid should be normal saline with 5% dextrose. And measure electrolytes every 4 hours until stable. And this is also very important. When you are having a hyponatremic child, overly aggressive correction of hyponatremia is also very, very dangerous. So you can see, if the child is in the, if the cell is in isotonic solution, cell is very happy, no net shift of fluid inside or outside. In acute hyponatremia, the cell is in hypotonic solution now, water will go in so that the cell will swollen up. So body will not wait until something happens. Body is trying to find a solution for this problem. So it's called adaptation. over the ensuing few days, the brain cell pumps out the osmose. The cell will pump out some of the osmose so that ultimately it will come to an equilibrium. So it's a hyponatremic solution, but now the cell has pumped out some solutes to become equal to these sites. So now all of a sudden, if you put hypertonic solution, what will happen is again the water will go out from this cell, causing shrinking of this cell. So this is called syndrome of osmotic demyelination happening in brain. So again, you can think about this, brain cell is very happy when you're having isotonic solution, and acute hyponatremia, lot of fluid is going inside. So with adaptation, body is trying to send some osmoles out. With that, the water also will go out. And again, there's the relatively similar osmolality in both sides. So the cell is happy again. And now we are sending hypertonic solution to treat this hyponatremia. Now the water will go out and the cell will shrunken up, can cause syndrome of osmotic demyelination. So that's why the aggressive correction of hyponatremia also you should not do. Right. So then comes to the hypernatremia. And again, the mild hypernatremia is relatively common. And risk of hypernatremia increases with level of serum sodium. And treatment can be very complicated and potentially dangerous. So if you have hypernatremic child, if you don't know what to do, please seek expert advice early. So that is the definition. We call it mild hypernatremia when the sodium level is 146 to 149. Moderate hypernatremia, 150 to 169. Severe hypernatremia, more than 117. Again, too rapid reduction of sodium can cause cell edema, convulsion, and permanent brain injury. So overly aggressive treatment should be avoided. And very, very close monitoring is critical. So if the child is shocked, you have to give 20 ml per kilo normal saline as required. So there's no difference between hypernatremic dehydration and normal natremic dehydration if the child is in shock. So airway, breathing, circulation is same. Then the fluid management is based on initial serum sodium. So if you're having a mild hypernatremic dehydration, rarely requires specific treatment management and repeat in 4 to 6 hours if clinically indicated. You have moderate hypernatremic dehydration, that is sodium level is 150 to 169. So after initial resuscitation, you have to replace the fluid deficit over 48 hours with normal saline. So hypernatremic dehydration should be corrected by normal saline, but you are going to replace the fluid deficit over 48 hours. As you will know, if it is a normal natremic dehydration without hypernatremia, usually we are correcting the fluid deficit over 24 hours. Here, we are correcting the deficit over 48 hours. And severe hypernatremic dehydration, sodium is more than 170, so it's a medical emergency. Definitely, you need a tertiary care referral, contact ICU, and resuscitation is same. So after initial resuscitation, you have to replace the deficit over 72 to 96 hours, again with normal saline. So no place for hyponatremic solutions in the management of hypernatremia. And consider peritoneal dialysis if the serum sodium is more than 180. So hypernatremia, aim for slow correction. So you are expecting about 12 to 15 millimoles for 24 hours. Over 24 hours, you're going to correct about 12 millimoles per liter. So that doesn't mean you can continue about 23 hours and within last hour you can drop by 12. So it should be 0.5 millimoles per kg, 0.5 millimoles per hour. So within 24 hours, you're correcting only by 12 millimoles. No place for hypernatremic solution. Always use normal saline, and you have to do serum electrolytes 4 to 6 hourly and seek expert advice early. What about decay? So decay is a unique condition. The glucose cannot enter the cell because lack of insulin. So here, our osmolality in extracellular compartment is sodium plus glucose. Basically, it's 2 times sodium plus glucose. So what will happen? Initially, osmolality is same. This is the normal condition. Extracellular ion is sodium, intracellular ion is potassium. Both sides, osmolality is 280. But here, in diabetes, we are adding some glucose to the extracellular compartment. So now this 280 has become 320, but by adding 40 millimoles per liter of glucose. Now, intracellular osmolality is 280, extracellular osmolality is 320. So as we discussed earlier, the fluid will shift from intracellular to extracellular. So with time, your extracellular osmolality will drop and your intracellular osmolality will go up. So ultimately, it will come to an equilibrium in a higher level. So in between, it should be between 320 and 280. It should be higher than 280, it should be lower than 320. Ultimately, a similar condition, similar situation will occur, but the osmolality is high. So in DKA, is a hyperosmolar condition. For the explanation, I'm just taking, it says 320 both sides. So how can this 320 occurs? Sodium 140, 2 times sodium is 280, plus 40 now becomes 320. So in the brain cell or the intracellular compartment also is 320. So now we can see what will happen. If you drop this osmolality, if you use hyponatremic IV fluids to this condition, giving N by 2, sodium is 77, osmolality is 144. So you are dropping extracellular osmolality. The fluid will shift from extracellular to intracellular compartment and cause cellular edema. So at any stage, you should not use hyponatremic IV fluids in DKA. If you give normal saline, now look at the extracellular volume is 1 liter. I'm taking it at 1 liter. So this is the ion composition. Now I'm going to add another 1 liter of normal saline. So now sodium contents in this 1 liter is 154. So this becomes 2 liters. I have done the calculation. Initially osmolality is 320, but now after adding 1 liter of normal saline, it has become 314. What I'm trying to say is, even with normal saline, you can drop your extracellular osmolality in DKA. So if you use a lot of normal saline, you see I'm going to add 9 liters of normal saline. So what will happen? I have done the calculation. Osmolality has dropped to 308. So if you give more normal saline, osmolality drop is more severe. So large volume of normal saline, you drop your extracellular osmolality, fluid will shift from extracellular to intracellular compartment and you can cause cell edema. That is why in all the guidelines, whether you are using 2005 or 2015 or 2020, whatever the guidelines, they are trying to restrict the amount of fluid that you are using in DKA in various stages. So in DKA, even normal saline is hypotonic. In the management, always use normal saline. Minimum volume needing to maintain hemodynamics, and again correct the dehydration deficit over 48 to 72 hours. So it's like hypernatremic dehydration. Dengue, again now dengue is coming, so you should be thorough with this management. You have seen this slide again and again. So in dengue, what happens? Dengue hemorrhagic fever, what happens? You are starting your leak here. Gradually leak will go up. Maximum leaks around 24 hours. Then leak will go down, leak will stop by 48 hours. Leak will start gradually increasing, maximum leaks around 24 hours. We call this part as ascending limb. Then the leak will go down and stop by 48 hours. And we call this part as descending limb. So this is the usual pattern. So if you want to manage dengue properly, you have to match the leak. So basically what you do is gradually you should increase the amount of fluid that you are giving. Maximum amount is usually needed around 24 hours, then the amount of fluid should go down. So this is our usual dengue fluid chart. Starting with a small amount, it may be 2, it may be 3, it may be 4, 5, whatever it is, and gradually it should increase depending on the patient's need. Usually maximum fluid requirement is around 24 hours and then it should go down, and after about 48 hours you can come to minimum amount of fluid. So basically what we're doing is we are matching the leak. If the child presents with shock, you know that the maximum leak is around 24 hours. So usually shock occurs around this period. So if the child comes here with shock, that means this part has already occurred at home. So we have to manage from this point onwards. So what you should do, initially you need huge amount of fluid to match this leak when the child is in shock. But after that, gradually the fluid amount should come down, and the fluid requirement is usually for about 24 hours. If the child comes with shock, this 24 hours has already occurred and we have to look after next 24 hours only. So our fluid chart is like this. So initially you are giving huge amount of fluid, gradually coming down, and at the end of 24 hours, basically you are giving minimum amount of fluid. Again, you are matching the leak. So what type of IV fluids? So always isotonic crystalloid solution for infusion and boluses. You can use normal saline, you can use Hartmann's. The hypertonic colloids, nowadays we are using only dextran, 40% dextran. This is for bolus. Again, sometimes in some patients, some wards, we are using 40% dextran at infusion, but that is not recommended. Indications for colloid: if the child is in shock, after two crystalloid boluses, we have to think about colloid. If the child is in shock, already having fluid overload, if you are giving a lot of fluid, then you can think about colloid. And if the child is in shock, you know the patient is going towards fluid overload because now we are giving a lot of fluid, again, you can think about colloid. So these are the only three indications for colloid, nothing else. And colloid administration, only during the critical phase, only as boluses, no infusions, and bolus is 10 ml per kilo. There's nothing called half bolus. If you need dextran, you have to give the proper bolus. And maximum 3 boluses in 24 hours and 6 in 48 hours. Dextran is a drug, so you have to use it carefully. That's why there's a maximum dose. Indications of blood in DHF. If you see significant overbleeding, in other words, you can see the blood, you can give blood. And if you are suspecting of concealed bleeding, that means your PCV is dropping without any clinical improvement. You know, in dengue, if the child is having more leak, your PCV should rise. So when the patient is bad, when the patient is having problems, your PCV, the expected PCV is high. But if the PCV is dropping, but you're basically thinking about the child is improving, you're having good fluid status, the child should improve. So if the child is not improving, still the PCV is low, then it should be DD. So if the PCV drops without clinical improvement, definitely you have to give blood. And end organ dysfunction, despite adequate fluid, another indication to give blood. So hyponatremia in dengue is very common. It's a common cause of convulsion in dengue. If the child with dengue is having convulsion, it may be febrile convulsion, it may be due to hyponatremia, it may be due to hypocalcemia. So think about these things. And this can cause cerebral edema and corning. So use only isotonic fluid in dengue. So there's no place for any other type of fluids when you're managing dengue hemorrhagic fever. So in summary, DHF, always use normal saline. Like DKA, minimum volume needed to maintain hemodynamics. Match the leak, use blood and dextran rationally, and prevent shock as well as fluid overload. So if you are suspecting raised ICP, if you have meningitis or encephalitis, so our main aim for the management is maintaining the adequate cerebral perfusion pressure. So this is the common cartoon that I'm using always. So this is my intracranial compartment. This is the mean arterial pressure. This is central venous pressure. If you want to send blood through this intracranial compartment, you need to have a higher mean arterial pressure, lower central venous pressure. In other words, your cerebral perfusion pressure equals to mean arterial pressure minus ICP. If the ICP is high, CPP is low. If you think about the ICP and CVP, if the CVP is higher than ICP, this fluid shift or the arterial blood flow will depend on the CVP. That's why I have put it CVP. So anyway, so what we should do? So if we want to maintain the cerebral perfusion, you need higher mean arterial pressure and lower ICP. So if you want to maintain the cerebral perfusion pressure, you have to increase mean arterial pressure. So you can give volume, you can give inotropes, you can give vasopressors. To decrease the intracranial pressure, you can use hypertonic saline. So osmotically is active. You can use mannitol, again is osmotically active. Whether you can use external ventricular drainage, nowadays it's very commonly done in LRH. So you can just put a catheter to the third ventricle, the lateral ventricle. So drain some extra cerebrospinal fluid so you can control the ICP. And at the end, if everything fails, you can remove the flap from one side of the cranium. So then this ICP concept is gone, because it is open to the atmospheric pressure, it has become atmospheric pressure. Mannitol versus hypertonic saline. Yes, mannitol is osmotically active substance. It can reduce intracranial pressure, that's true. But at the same time, it will reduce the mean arterial pressure also, because it's a vasodilator. So mannitol will decrease ICP and decrease mean arterial pressure. So what will happen to the CPP? We don't know. In contrast, in 3% saline, it will decrease the ICP because it's osmotically active. At the same time, it acts as volume that will increase your mean arterial pressure. It will decrease ICP, it will increase mean arterial pressure. So ultimately, in two ways, you are increasing the cerebral perfusion pressure. So in two ways, you are increasing cerebral perfusion pressure. Obviously, the 3% saline is better than mannitol. What about the maintenance fluid or versus restricted fluid in conditions which cause cerebral edema? So obviously, if you think about this equation, you should not restrict the volume. In fact, sometimes you have to use normal maintenance, even more than normal maintenance, to maintain the cerebral perfusion pressure. But our practice was to cut down fluid whenever you are managing meningitis or encephalitis. So this was a Cochrane review about how to manage the maintenance fluid in meningitis. But they say no significant difference in number of death, whether you're using maintenance fluid or restricted fluid, but significant difference in spasticity, seizures, chronic serious neurological sequelae at 3 months follow-up. Basically, morbidity has increased if you restrict the fluid. So maintenance fluid is better than restricted fluid in the management of meningitis or encephalitis. So physiologically, you can explain it. Now the Cochrane review also has explained this. Please use at least normal maintenance fluid in the management of meningitis. So summary, meningitis or encephalitis, always use normal saline, no hypotonic fluids, no fluid restriction, at least maintenance fluid, sometimes fluid boluses. And if you have to maintain cerebral perfusion pressure, so 3% saline is better than mannitol. Right, so now we have come to the end of this lecture. So take home messages of this lecture, prescribe IV fluid as medicines. Just because you are having a lot of IV fluids, just don't prescribe it haphazardly. prescribed by the fluid as medicine. So remember, oral fluids are having very low sodium. Even ORS is having 75 to 90. So oral fluids are having very low sodium. Any child needing IV fluid, risk of hypernatremia due to high antidiuretic hormone. If the child is nil by mouth, add glucose to IV fluids. So that's called the dextrose plus the normal saline with 5% dextrose. And frequent monitoring and assessment is a must. And ready to change your treatment plan frequency. Just because you have taken this in the morning, that doesn't mean that you have to continue until tomorrow morning. And at the end, select the IV fluid, rate, as well as volume, depending on the disease physiology. So that is very important. I always believe this. It's better to walk alone than with a crowd going in the wrong direction. Thank you very much. Any questions?